All right, hello everybody. Robert Breaker here again, and I just thought I'd do this quick video for you. I've got a book here that I've recently read that I think everybody should read, and it's one of the best books I've ever read on this subject, and I'm going to talk about this a little bit today. Let me see if I can get over there and show you this book up close. You say, are you going to talk about the Civil War again? Well, yes, I am. Everything you were taught about the Civil War is wrong. By Locke Lane Seabrook. And I think I have a favorite new author. Everything I knew as a Southerner about the Civil War and all the facts are just happened to be in this book and just laid out perfectly. So if you want to know more about the Civil War, I would ask y'all to get this book. I bought it on Amazon.com. Everything You Were Taught About the Civil War is Wrong by Locke Lane Seabrook. And this was an easy read and a good read, and I enjoyed it. I also got another book by him. Abraham Lincoln was a liberal. Jefferson Davis was a conservative. This is what it looks like. And he even wrote another book, Confederate Flag Facts. So I pretty much have found a new author that I really like, Locke Lane Seabrook. It's kind of interesting because my dad grew up in Seabrook, Texas. I don't know, that's just kind of neat. But when I grew up here in the South in Milton, Florida, I'll never forget being in about 6th, 7th, 8th grade, one of those, because I was in middle school. I remember our teacher teaching in history class, and she says, now, one thing I want you all to remember is this. She says, I want you all to remember that the South was right, and it was about states' rights. And I remember being taught that in a secular school here in Milton, Florida. And I remember my teacher saying that, and saying, now, I want you to study it. She said, you get to college, sure as the world, they're going to teach you that it was all about slavery. But they're wrong if you study it out. She said that. So let's start today with Isaiah chapter 5 and verse 20. Woe unto them that call evil good and good evil, that put darkness for light and light for darkness, that put bitter for sweet and sweet for bitter. Woe unto them that are wise in their own eyes and prudent in their own sight. God says there's a woe on somebody if he calls evil good and evil and good evil. And God says, you think you're wise, you really need to study. See, there are a lot of people out there that think they've got this Civil War thing figured out. And they're going by revisionist history. They're going by what the victors wrote. And they're not going to the source to see for themselves what the truth is. So a lot of people are wrong about the Civil War. And they think the North was right and the South was wrong. And they justify this belief by saying, and the South were slave owners and they were evil. And I can't tell you how many times I heard people say the evil South or the evil Confederates or the evil Confederacy or the evil Southern people. And I look at that and I go, well, that's not the South that I grew up in. That's not the South that I know. The other day, I went fishing out at Carpenter's Park where I did my video recently about the COVID-19 as an attack. I was fishing there and I drove in and I drove right by the boat launch. And I saw something that just confirmed to me what I already know, having studied this all out, that everything we're being taught today is a lie. Today, when they see the Confederate flag, they say, racist hate, and that's what you're supposed to believe because they say that. Well, I saw something that was interesting. I saw a black man in a pickup truck with Confederate flags all over it, launching his bass boat with a white friend. Now, you're supposed to believe that the Confederate flag is racist and that whites and blacks in the South, why they hate each other. That's what they try to get across to you. And here was a white guy and a black guy that were friends. And I don't know if the black guy owned the truck, but he was driving a truck that had Confederate flags all over. Right there in the front window shield, right there hanging off of the mirror, everything. And I said, why would a black guy have a Confederate flag unless he knew what I knew? And that what a lot of people are teaching today is lies. So when you study out the Civil War, you can see why a black guy would like the Confederate flag. It's about heritage, not about hate. Many of you I've told to look up H.K. Edgerton, a man in South Carolina who is a Confederate black man. And he's a man who's black that loves the Confederate flag. Now this book, Everything You Were Taught About the Civil War is Wrong, the very beginning of this book is quite amazing to me. Because the very beginning of this book is a foreword by Nelson W. Winbush. Nelson W. Winbush, he's a black man standing in front of a Confederate flag. He says, my grandfather, Louis Napoleon Nelson was a Confederate soldier who in his later years remained many of his war experiences to me. At age 14, he accompanied his master's two sons, Sidney and E.R. Oldman, as members of the 7th Kentucky Cavalry. Louis, this guy's grandfather, was made the temporary chaplain. Later at Lookout Mountain, his position was made official, making him the only known black Confederate chaplain. He told me that when he was conducting services, it was not uncommon for Confederates and Yankees to worship together. When the service was over, soldiers returned to their respective sides to resume firing at each other. This guy continues, this is a black man talking about how he loves the Confederate flag, how it's a flag of heritage to him, and how his grandfather was a Southern black man who was a black chaplain during the war. And he says here, history has a strange way of recording things. To the victor go the spoils, but the war between the states, there was no real winner. And I believe that. We're still suffering today from that war. And he continues here. Now, this book, Everything You Were Taught About Civil War Is Wrong, is an excellent book. Now, I remember when I was in Bible school at Pensacola Bible Institute, and I remember, was it the day where we took the class picture? It might have been that day. It might have been a different day. But I remember old Peter Ruckman was sitting there, and here came the assistant pastor, and I was sitting on the front row, and I listened to what the assistant pastor said. Assistant pastor came out and gave a book to Ruckman, my old pastor. And he says, well, Ruckman, you convinced me the South was right. Now, this man was a Yankee. And Dr. Ruckman said, hey, the South was right. Let me show you some books in order for you to understand, what I see. Now, Ruckman grew up in Maryland, so he was born a Yankee. I can't tell you how many friends I have down here in the South that are Yankees. And they all tell me, Breaker, the South was right. I said, were you taught that as a kid? No, as a Yankee, they said the South was evil and now South is wicked. I moved down here. I saw something that I couldn't figure out. Why were the people so kind? Why were they so nice? Why was everything just so great? Why was there such Southern hospitality? Why was there a church on every street corner? And they said, you know what? I began to study the Civil War and I found out the South was right and the North was wrong. And that's what you come to in a conclusion if you just simply look at the facts. And so I'll never forget that assistant pastor saying, well, Ruckman, you convinced me the South was right. I've met other people too, and many of them, same thing. I've studied this out for myself. So one of the best books to find on the truth about the Civil War is this one. And it's modern. It's a new book. It was written, let me see if I can find you the date that this was written. And I would ask you, as my viewer, to please get this book and read this book and find out about this book and find out for yourself. Well, it was literally written in 2010, but it's been updated several times up to 2019 by Locklane Seabrook. Okay? Now, there's so many things, and the way that this book is set up, it's pretty cool. It's set up by saying, you were taught, well, here's the truth. You were taught, here's the truth. You go through the whole book, it's you were taught this, but here's the truth. And that's what's so amazing about this book. I would ask you to get it. It's really will help you, okay? Now, this book is the one entitled Abraham Lincoln Was a Liberal, Jefferson Davis Was a Conservative. Now, if you get this book will help you as well to see America today and how it was before. And this is what's interesting to me. Democrats were the ones in the South, and they were conservatives. The Yankees were liberals, and they were Republicans. Today, it's the exact opposite. Today, many of your Republicans claim to be conservatives, and many of your Democrats claim to be liberals. So we've seen a complete reversal, all right? Abraham Lincoln is the equivalent of a modern-day Democrat socialist. And if you look into Lincoln, Lincoln actually liked a big government. He wasn't in favor of a small government. He wanted a big government. You look at Jefferson Davis, he wanted small government. He was a conservative. Even though he was a Democrat, he was more like our modern Republicans. Even though Lincoln was a Republican, he's more like our modern Democrats. And so this book really explains it well. And this book goes back to the American Revolution and the founding of America and how there were two parties. And the two parties were the Federalist Party and the Anti-Federalist Party. The Federalist Party was the big government party. They wanted the Union, and they thought, this is what the Federalists thought, people were too dumb to govern themselves, so they believe the government should take over control and control people because people are too dumb to control themselves. That's your modern liberal, that's your modern socialist, communist, slash progressive Democrat today. And that was the Federalist Party. The anti-federalists were those that said people need to be the sovereigns of their own homes, of their own lands, of their own states, states' rights, and they believed people had the right to govern themselves, and they wanted a small government. And they wanted the federal government to not get into people's business. So from the very beginning, you had liberal conservative. And then as time went on, you had liberal conservative. And so I've not quite finished this book, but this book also will explain to you. And this whole issue is this: control your life. There have always been the liberals that wanted to control you and not let you have certain rights because they don't believe that you can govern yourself well. They want to be in charge of you. And you've always had a faction of people in America that says, no, we want government out of our life, not be intrusive on us, and we want to govern ourselves. And that's what's always been in America since its founding. Now, you've got to understand the mind of an American. When America was started, well, it was under the king, King George. Even before that, before King George, you had the founding of America, and many Americans were British people. But then the British were angry with King George for trying to tax them and take away their rights. And so they fought a brutal war, the American Revolution, in which George Washington, who, by the way, would have been a modern conservative, they fought and they won that war. And the American Revolution was no taxation without equal representation. That's what that war was about. You don't have a right to tax and take away from us what's ours. Get out of our lives, leave us alone. The more you tax us, the more you're taking from us. And that's what big government does. Big government wants to get into everything, so they need more money to get bigger. Well, the less money you give the government, the smaller they are, the more free you'll be. That's always been the thinking and the understanding. Well, Lincoln was a big government guy. He was a Federalist. And so Lincoln's desire was the Union to get bigger and to get stronger and to not give people rights, to take away many of the rights they did have so that the government would get bigger. The South said, we don't want that. So when you begin studying the Civil War and you compare it to the American Revolution, there's not much difference. We fought England in the American Revolution because we said no taxation without representation. We want to be free, and we at least want to vote on what we believe and have an equal representation in our vote and less taxes. And we won, and everyone said America was right. America was right because they fought for freedom, and freedom from oppression and freedom from overtaxation. Well, Lincoln comes along and he's elected, and the South says, we believe that we have the right to legally secede. And he goes in really well in this book showing how the Constitution, the Declaration of Independence, much of what was taught during the time of the Civil War, taught that it is 100% legal to secede from the Union, and that every state has a right. Matter of fact, he goes in this book and tells about how some northern states said, hey, if you don't do what we give us our rights and you don't, you know, do like we say, we're going to secede. So the North threatened to secede first before the South, many years before, back in the early 1800s. So the South seceded from the Union because of the moral tariff. The moral tariff was a tax of up to 48% of the income of the South. The South said, we don't like that. And what happened was the North, the Republicans, started bringing in all these people from Catholic Ireland, and the Irish kept coming in, and the North began to grow and get more representation in Congress based upon this more of a population. And guess what? Exact same reason the first war was fought, the War of Independence. No taxation without equal representation. The South said, we're not getting the representation. We can't vote against this 48% tax, the moral, M-O-R-R-I-L-L tariff. So we secede. And they did. They were just and they were righteous in seceding. Okay? Here's the thing. People run around and say the evil South, the wicked South, the wicked Confederacy, the wicked. And it's all because they use as an excuse slavery and say the South was evil because they owned slaves. They don't ever deal with what's legal. All right? There's a moral argument, there's a legal argument. Sometimes the law is moral, sometimes the law is immoral. Okay? That's just fact. Sometimes there are laws on the books that are immoral. To me, one of the most immoral laws in the world is the law of abortion. They allow abortion in America. But abortion is murder, according to the Bible. They're killing people, and it's sad. So I don't believe in abortion. I think abortion is a horrible thing, but it's the law. Well, do you follow the law? That's the question. Well, for me, I'm not going to get an abortion, so it's not a law that I'm worried about. But it is sad to me that there are people that will follow that law and go kill their own baby. To me, that's just sad. I think that's an immoral law. And so I'm going to say that's bad. That's wrong. That's bad. All right, so America was founded under this flag. And when America was founded, it was American ships that brought slaves to America. And it was the 13 colonies, many of them which were up north, that founded this country under this flag. And this flag started slavery. And they allowed slavery, and it became the law of the land. It came on the books. Now, many people said, well, we don't want slavery. And so they said, well, let's take a vote to abolish slavery and to stop sending ships in. Well, it was the northern states that profited upon the slavery movement and bringing in of slaves. And according to this book, he does a great job of showing you, and I don't have time to read it. I want you to get it. I want you to read this book. But he shows you how there was a vote, and the northern states voted, no, let's keep sending in slaves for another 30 years. So the northern states instituted slavery. The northern states profited off of slavery. Many of the ships that went and got slaves and brought them back were northern. And then the north allowed the law and voted on keeping slavery coming in. That was this flag. You know what's interesting? Never once was there a ship that brought slaves to America under this flag. Not one time. Never. I find that interesting. So it's this flag that instituted and allowed slavery and voted to continue the trade of slaves. So the South seceded from the North, and the South just wanted to be free. Now, 95% of the South did not own slaves. 5% did. So it's very hard to say the war was only over keeping slaves when 95% of the people in the South didn't own slaves. And he does a good job of going in and showing you that. What the war was about was just wanting to be free. Just like the American Revolution, wanting to be free from a dictator, from a tyrant who's trying to tax you without equal representation. All the South wanted was to be free. Now, the South had already decided they didn't want to bring in any more slaves. And he goes in and shows you many of the laws they put in the books in the South and how they said, we're not going to allow any more slave traders to sell slaves in the South. Many historians say that slavery would have eventually ended had it been left alone. And so this book does a great job and goes through and shows you the true South and how it was indeed over state rights, how it was all about the South wanting their freedom from a tyrant, from a dictator. And it does a great job showing you how evil Abraham Lincoln was. I've heard many people say, well, if you fought for the South, if you were Confederate, you were treasonous. You were guilty of treason. Let's put that to rest right now. That is an outright lie. The South legally seceded from the Union, and they formed their own country. All right, that country then became its own nation with its own constitution. So guess what that means? They weren't treasonous. To be treasonous is to turn against your own government and fight against it. They didn't do that. They legally left the Union and then fought for their own country, their new country. This book goes into detail very well of how treasonous many of the things that Lincoln did. If ever there was someone guilty of treason to the Constitution, it was Abraham Lincoln. And you'll see that if you'll read the book. And you see, this book, all this book does is put together everything that I've already read and already learned in many other books. So that's why I'm recommended this book here. And many of the things that Lincoln did were atrocious, just atrocious. He got rid of habeas corpus. Check into that. Find out what habeas corpus is. We still don't have it to this day because that man Lincoln got rid of it. Lincoln was a racist, and he shows you many of the quotes of Lincoln, how Lincoln says, I don't like black people, and how Lincoln's plan was to send all black people back to Africa, and many of the racist things that Lincoln said. If you go through this book, you'll see just how Christian the South was, just how they wanted to defend themselves, how they were invaded by the North, how Lincoln started the Civil War by lies and twisting of history in order to make it look like the South had turned against the Constitution. They didn't. They followed it to secede and start their own country. And when they did, this man Lincoln attacked that country. And he always viewed them as rebels to the Constitution when he himself would not follow the Constitution. And I could go into so many different things in this book, and I wish I could. But I've got some friends. Someone contacted me the other day, said, Brother Breaker, I'm a black person, and I just bought myself a Confederate flag because I looked into it, and you're right, the South was right. There's a lot of things in this book that are just incredible, but it's not about what they say it is. Let's just say they try to make this a moral thing in which the South was immoral, and they try to make the South out to be treasonous. Well, all the South ever did was try to defend itself and its rights and have small government, not big government, and defend itself from attack from a foreign nation and follow the law. Now, I hate slavery. I'll be the first to say I don't like slavery. But it was the law. And the South believed in following the law because the majority of the people in the South were Christians. Matter of fact, the abolition movement started in the South, not in the North. That's another thing a lot of people don't know. A lot of people think, oh, the North were good, righteous people because they started the abolitionist movement. In fact, no, it was actually started in the South. And many of the abolitionists in the North were communists. They followed Karl Marx. And they believed in killing people that didn't agree with them. John Brown did that, and others. And when you look at the North and the South, you see the North was a whole bunch of Unitarians, Universalists, and Catholics who did not believe in the Word of God as written. You look at the South, it was many Protestants and many Bible believers who believed the Bible. If you're from Scotland, you know what that flag is. Why, that's the Scottish cross, the cross of Scotland. So as you study this out and you look at the South, you find the South was guilty of wanting to continue following the law. And so they wanted the law, and the law allowed slavery at the time, and that's a sad thing. But there were a lot of people in the South that had slaves, but they didn't like slavery, and they looked at it as an immoral thing, and they wanted to get rid of it. And many people in the South wanted to get rid of slavery. That's true. And there were a lot of men in the South that lived in a time when it was part of the law, but they said, you know what we're going to do? We're gonna not do it. I was reading through here. One of my favorite men is Stonewall Jackson. He was one of the most amazing men with character, a godly Christian man with much character. And this guy, Stonewall Jackson, was just an incredible person. That's why a lot of our heroes in the South are men like Robert E. Lee and others, because they were honorable men. They practiced chivalry. They practiced Christianity. And they had a strong moral character, as opposed to men like Sherman, who raped women and burned down houses, as opposed to men like Lincoln that would hold seances in the White House, as opposed to men like Grant who got drunk every night. Evil men up North, no morals whatsoever, many of them. In the South, we prided ourselves upon being good Christian people who followed the Bible and followed the law. So there was laws in the land in the South, well, actually in the North, in favor of slavery, allowing slavery, and it was a bad thing. A lot of people in the South didn't want slaves. And they didn't have them. Like I said, 5% of the people in the South owned slaves, 95% didn't. But the slavery that existed in the South was very different from the slavery in the North. Matter of fact, 30% of the North owned slaves, 5% of the South owned slaves. So what a difference, you know? Way more slavery in the North than the South. But in the South, they didn't look down on black people and treat them with disrespect. Many times they accepted them as part of the family. Many times they looked at them affectionately as an aunt or an uncle. Aunt so-and-so, they would call their black slave. Or Uncle Remus. You ever heard of Uncle Remus? Many of the children were raised with the black children and always looked at them as friends till the day they died. I was reading in this book about things I already knew. Okay, for example, I already knew Robert E. Lee, he didn't own slaves. And then he inherited slaves from his wife's family. And he let them go and he freed them because he didn't like slavery. See, they want to demonize people in the South, say, evil slave owners. Well, if they did own slaves, it was because it was an inheritance, and many of them said, I don't want that. So I'm reading about Stonewall Jackson, and Stonewall Jackson was amazing. There were these two people that came to Stonewall Jackson and said, we want to be your slaves. Now, you've got to understand the South. A lot of people look at the South and say, oh, evil slavery, but they don't understand there were many, many, many laws in favor of the slaves in the South. And one of the laws in the South was if you kill a slave, then you forfeit your life and you're dead. You kill the white person, sometimes you could get away with it or have life in jail, but if you kill the black slave, you were dead. You lost your life. I mean, they were stronger and more in favor of the blacks than the whites many times. But there were laws in the South about slavery that if a person was a slave and they had a master who was bad, who was evil, who was mean, who beat them or things like that, the slave could go to the magistrates, to the constable, to the people in charge, and the slave could request a change of master and say, we don't want this person to be our master, we want someone else. And this book goes through and shows you many cases about that, how it was very common that slaves would seek out the most Christian, the most nice, the most loving, caring people. And yes, they would have known who they were because slaves would have talked to other slaves. And then, well, my master is nice. My master. And they said, boy, I wish he was my master, kind of thing. And there were many times that slaves would go seek out another master and say, hey, would you purchase me? Because this guy's not very nice to me. And that was very common. Well, Stonewall Jackson didn't own any slaves in his life, except for two. Do you know why Stonewall Jackson owned two slaves? Because they came to him and said, Stonewall, and oftentimes if their master died, they had a right to choose who would purchase them, and they would always seek out the most Christian, most nice person. And these two slaves came to Stonewall Jackson and said, would you purchase us because you are a man of good character, you are a Christian, you are an honorable man, and if we're going to serve somebody, we want to serve you. Stonewall Jackson says, I don't like slavery, I don't want slaves. And they said, please, we want you. He said, I will purchase you as my slaves on one condition, that as soon as you pay me back what I paid for you, you let me free you. And they did that. And Stonewall Jackson bought those people as slaves, according to the law, and freed them as soon as they had paid off what he purchased them for. Now you tell me that's an evil confederacy, huh? That's an evil confederate. You don't know what you're talking about. You need to read history. How about the guy named Forrest, Nathaniel Bedford Forrest? One of the most richest men in the world in his time, Nathaniel Bedford Forrest. He had something like 30 slaves. He loved them. He accepted them as family. He took care of them. Civil War started. He said, all right, y'all free. They said, we don't want to be free. We want to fight with you. We care for you. We love you. And they fought with him. And after the war, he lost everything. He died a bankrupt man. But he took care of every one of those people that he owned as slaves before. He went into debt taking care of them. And they loved him so much they wouldn't leave him. There's story after story after story I've read of after the Civil War, slaves staying, ex-slaves, I guess you could say, where they were free now, even though how does that Emancipation Proclamation free slaves in a different country? And that's what, it was two different countries at the time. But there's many slaves that stayed with their masters and took care of them. Said, no, we're not slaves, we're family. We're family. And that's why it's so common to find black people loving this flag. And you Democrats in Washington, you see that and all you see is hate. And you say, that's a flag of hate. You are the most ignorant people. And you're showing your ignorance because you've never studied that flag to find out what it really means. It means freedom from tyranny, and it means Christianity, and it means following the law. Yes, there were some abuses under slavery, but not that many. And when you study that out, you find things like this. A black man who joined the South and became a chaplain. And you find out all these things where many black people were servants, and they loved their masters, and they were like family. And so I just wanted to share that with you and ask you to get that book and find out for yourself what it's about. Because there were many, and this book really paints a picture of how it looks like almost half of the Confederacy Army was black people, when you do the math correctly. And he went through and he's found all the history, and he says about half of the South of the army were black people. yeah, they're really fighting for slavery, huh? They're fighting to stay enslaved. That's not what it's about. It was a war about invaders coming into their land and into their country and trying to take over. Lincoln was a despot. If you don't believe me, look at the Maryland song. The song of Maryland is thy despot's foot is upon thy heel, O Maryland. And Maryland really didn't like what Lincoln did as he took over their state. They were going to vote, and they were going to vote to leave the Union because they didn't agree with Lincoln. Lincoln sent in troops, and by bayonet point allowed his troops to vote in the Maryland, and they voted to keep Maryland part of the Union. Maryland would have said, no, we're leaving. So there were a lot of abuses during the Civil War. But the South was right. They didn't do anything wrong. They simply tried to follow the law and follow the Constitution, something that Lincoln did not. So before you go around, like some of you on YouTube making your videos saying Robert Breaker's in favor of the evil Confederacy, maybe you should study to show yourself approved unto God, a workman that needeth not to be ashamed, and look for yourself to see what the Bible says and what history says about the Civil War. Because the South didn't do anything wrong. They were just opposed to tyranny and evil, and they wanted to be free, have a small government, and have the right to govern themselves. and the abuses, the outright war crimes from the North on the South are so sad. And I appreciate this man, whoever he is, Lachlan Seabrook, putting together everything I knew into one place so that people can get this one book. I recommend this one book for everybody to get together and read. Because if you read this book and you see history as it really is, you can't help but see that the South was right and didn't do anything wrong. Just wanted to be left alone. If anything, the South was too nice. Because Robert E. Lee said the reason that he surrendered, he said, I just got so tired of seeing young men get killed. He should have waited. If he'd waited something like 6 days, boy, our world would be different, wouldn't it? Wasn't it 6 days later that Lincoln was assassinated? A lot of people have compared George Washington to Robert E. Lee. George Washington stayed out on the field for 6 years knowing that he couldn't win. But he knew he had a cause that was righteous and just, and he was going to fight for it. And he won. Many say if Robert E. Lee would have done the same thing, he would have won, but he got tired after 4 years and quit. If he would have just waited, things could have been different. But I don't want to go into more into it. This isn't a fight that I want to fight, because this is 150 years ago, and who cares, you know? But it is worth looking into if you value freedom, if you value Christianity, if you value moral conduct and character, if you value chivalry, if you value, one of the greatest words that the South ever used was honor. The South fought with honor. And even though the North was burning and raping and pillaging the South as they invaded, Robert E. Lee says, we will not do that. We will not sink to their level. We will not do what they do. We will retain our honor. And to this day, the Southern Confederate honor is still there. Doesn't matter that most of the country doesn't see it. It's still there, and you'll find it if you'll study it for yourself. I pray you'll do that. I pray you'll get this book. One of the best books. Like I said, most of this I've read and studied and know, but this kind of put it all together in one place for you to see. And it's amazing. Everything you were taught about the Civil War is wrong. Ask a Southerner, Lachlan Seabrook. Please read it. And when you do, please get in touch with me. Tell me what you found out. Most everybody I ever talk to about this tells me, Brother Breaker, you explained it to me, and now I want a Confederate flag.